And welcome to Position 6, the Dota 2 podcast, in which I, Daniel Offen, aka Mr. Big Jams, get to know some of the most important, exciting people in the Dota 2 scene. This week's episode is of Duster. Duster attended the International at just 17, playing Position 5 for Team Pain, and has gone on to be the captain of Team FURIA now, who are one of the youngest teams currently in the DPC. They're a project for the future, but they're a very exciting team, and I'm looking forward to seeing what they do. If you'd like to talk about this episode where you're listening to it outside of YouTube, you can follow me on Twitter at Daniel Offen, and that's spelled Daniel and then double F-O, double Daniel and then O-double-F-E-N. I can't spell my own name apparently. And please do let me know there if you've got any feedback or comments about the way I produce these episodes. Anything is welcome. And the episode will kick off right now. So talk to me a little bit about Team FURIA. How did the team end up coming together?
So FURIA Project is about getting new players and making them stick together for a long time and make them the best. They did the same in CSGO. So they approached Stini, our coach, and he got all of us together. He pretty much got five boys, young boys, that he could teach. And I think I'm the only one with the more experience. The rest, they play the first LAN at the minor. It's a long project, long-term project.
Were they players that you played with before, or was this the first time you played with them?
I think I played with all of them. After I left Pain, I played with Murdoch, RDO, and Heiko. I played with them already. So we pretty much had a stack, a mix together. So it was easier for Asini to approach us. We were playing together already.
All right, okay. So it wasn't like he constructed a team out of nowhere. It's that you were players who already knew each other and were playing together.
There's four core. We are the core, pretty much, of the team.
Okay, and how's it been going at the moment? You've just removed a player. What's happening with the replacement of that? Is it a long process to find someone new? Tell me about why you decided to take him off the roster.
So NSR was playing a tryout stage. We weren't really sure about him. And when the tryout ended, we got together to talk and we realized it was not going to work. We had different opinions and different views of the game and how to deal with things in life. So it's just not going to work, I think. I think NSR is 27 years old. He's quite stubborn, I'd say. He has a strong belief, so it was hard to come together in something.
Is that strong beliefs about Dota or kind of personal clashes between the two?
Most Dota.
Okay. As you said, it's a young, very young team. NSR was the oldest and now he's left. So now you're all close to being under 20, I think. Is it a team that feels young and full of potential, or are you looking to succeed now?
Yeah, we are always looking for the long term. I think everyone is 19 now. Mm-hmm. Our new offlaner is going to be pretty young as well. So how is he? Something we have in mind. Get five young boys. Ashin, I think he's 27 and he helps us both in Dota and life. So we are always learning and we are always aiming for the long term.
Is there a model for that you follow? Do you look at other younger teams that stuck together for a little while? Because there's not been that many teams like yours and Dota of all under 20 players who have planned to stick together for a couple of years. Is there anyone that you look up to who did something similar?
I think our biggest inspiration is the CSGO team. Mm-hmm. We have the same philosophy because our owners, the FURIA philosophy comes from the owners and they teach the CSGO guys how to do it and now we are doing as well. So yeah, there's no really examples in Dota. Our inspiration is only the CSGO team.
And do you feel very supported by the organization? Does it feel like a definite home for you for a long time?
Yeah, it's definitely the best in Brazil, I think. And they're quite new as well. They're expanding pretty fast, I would say.
And for you, as a young Position 5, you're the, I think, and I'm not 100% certain on this, I did a bit of research, you're the youngest Position 5 who's attended a DPC event this year. Does it feel like that in terms of your own experience? Because obviously you have experience playing with a number of teams over a number of years, but you are much younger than everyone else in your position. Do you feel that you lack a certain something that other captains have, or do you feel that you have something that a lot of people have?
So before, when I played in Pain Gaming, I was not a captain. So mm-hmm. I have no experience in being a captain. That is my first season being a captain. So that's why I asked Asini, and Asini is helping me to be a better leader. So even though I have quite some experience in tournaments, that was my first as a captain in the minor. So I'm still learning. I'm still learning how to lead. And I think I talked to some captains before, and I feel like being a captain is more outside of the game and in game as well. So I lack a bit of outside of the game. I'm quite shy, I would say. So I'm not like a strong leader with a strong... I don't have a very strong presence. I lead well in game, but I don't have a very strong presence outside of the game. I would say Astini is our captain outside of the game, and I am just the in-game leader.
But you're aspiring to be a captain all round, would you say? Is that something you've always wanted to be, a captain?
Yeah, I'm learning with not only with Astini, but with other captains how to have the strong presence and be a better leader, pretty much.
Are there things that you need to learn in-game as well about captaining? Is it just presence and being able to make your voice heard, or do you think there's something more developmental that needs to be learned there?
There's always something to learn in Dota. So our coach helps us with that. He watches pretty much every single replay and every tournament, and he just watches everything, and he makes these spreadsheets where we learn everything that he watches.
Let's talk a little about the minor. So the minor was obviously quite difficult for you. You had probably games against one of the two strongest teams there. Did it feel like a bit of a hard run, or were you pleased with how some of it went?
Well, we got a tough group, that's for sure. But there was two games that I like. I think the first against Gambit was fine, and we were a bit scared, but the game was fine. And the first against Enigma was pretty good as well. I think we just crumbled under pressure. If we had more confidence, and if I was leading better as well, that would be a better minor. But we don't have anything against tough groups. I think it's best for us to play against the tough opponents always, so we can learn. So I got to play against Weeha as well, which is super fun. that was good.
And Weeha's the player that you played with before, am I correct in saying? Was it nice to see him again and see him in a different world?
Yeah, I wish I had more time to talk to him at the minor.
With the teams that you played against, was it good to learn against them? Because Enigma are obviously a team with huge amounts of experience, and you've played against big teams before at the international, but not with this squad. Do you feel the squad got stronger for having attended the minor?
We did got stronger, because we boot camp as well for 10 days, I think. We all played a lot of pubs, and we all increased our MMRs. So playing against Enigma and Gambit, we definitely got a lot stronger. And I think with the experience of the first LAN, I think we have more confidence now coming up to the next one. So that's helped a lot. Next time we face them, it's not going to be our first time, so we're going to be a lot more confident. So we got stronger, I think, in mind instead of Dota. Definitely got stronger in mind.
And as the player in the team who's attended the most LANs, that you mentioned before that the others hadn't attended any LANs, were there things that you helped them out with in terms of experience, or do you still feel not confident enough to talk other people through the experience of attending a LAN?
So I do my best to help them, but as I said, that was my first LAN as a captain, so I'm learning as well. I had different things to deal. When I was just a player, that was a lot easier. But with my experience, I tried to share with them ways to deal and how to be calm and stuff. But we also have a psychologist. He went to the tournament with us. Bernardo, he was helping us a lot. He was teaching pretty much everything and helping us deal with the pressure. He also helps the CSGO team. So he traveled a lot and he has a lot of experience. So he's helping both me and the team how to deal with that. Which is something new in Dota, I think.
Is the help there just psychological and the pressure, or do you think it helps you process your own game as well and get better as a player, kind of even outside of tournaments?
Just the psychology stuff. Dota stuff is all about his team. But most of the things he helps us, makes us play better. So
it's good to hear. Were you expecting to do well? Do you think you could win it, or do you go into it just thinking this is a good learning experience for us?
I think we all wanted to do our 100% best. I expected to win one map at least, so that was a bit disappointing, but I think we all play our best and we tried our best, and that's all that matters. If next time we try our best again and it works, perfect. If it doesn't, we're going to come back stronger.
And you're also, as well as being a young captain, a young position five, there aren't that many position fives at your age. Is position five the position that you always wanted to play? Because a lot of people will play four or three or even one or two and slip into position five later in their career. Have you always wanted to be a support, or is it just what's happened?
I started playing four at the beginning. Mm-hmm. Then Pain Gaming called me to be a five, and I had no experience. So the first time I played as five was in Pain Gaming, and we had a long season. So that was not something I wish, but I like it. It's how I played best, I think. I am a best five than four. And that was the agreement we had in Pain. And that was one of the motives I pretty much had to leave, because they wanted me to either be a four or be a captain. And at the time, I couldn't be. I didn't want to play four, and I didn't want to be a captain yet. So they went out with... They replaced me, pretty much.
But why not go back to four? What makes you a good five, you think, in your skill set?
I think the position four is more about skill, and position five is more game knowledge. So I found Heiko, which is a super skill guy, and I'm sure he does better than me at the four. He casts spells much better than me, so I think it fits the position better for him, and I can be the guy with the knowledge and experience helping them as a five. The
difference between playing a four and a five, you mentioned there, is very based around game knowledge, and I imagine your improvement as a player has been very contingent on you becoming better at understanding the whole of the game. But do you think there are other more mechanical things that you need to improve at that are quite unique to five as opposed to four?
Mechanical things?
Yeah, like at the experience of actually playing a game as a five, do you have to be better at different things, or is it just that you have to know more about the game?
The most mechanical thing you need to have as a support five is warding.
Mm-hmm.
And I lack a little bit of that. My wards are not very good, I think, and I have issues with the warding. So that's the main stuff I'm learning with Astini. He sent me prints about new wards and where people are warding and stuff. So that's my goal, pretty much, is to ward better and deward better. That's something I lack.
And in the current patch, five has probably changed the most out of any of the roles, in that you no longer need to pay for wards. A lot of people, like Insania, for example, have said that position five doesn't really exist anymore like it used to. Have you found that quite a jarring change, considering you were just learning the position?
It got really weird, I think. I think there's no position 4 and 5 anymore. They're mm-hmm. both, they both get strong in games. Support is very strong right now. And everyone can buy wards. Our mid player is even buying wards now. So, yeah, support 5 got a little bit weird, I think. You don't have to sacrifice that much. So players with more mechanic are doing a lot better, I think. If you're more skilled and you can do a lot with items, it's a great patch.
Do you like that?
Yeah, I like, because I was playing a 4 at the beginning of my career. Mm-hmm. So now I'm pretty much playing half 4, half 5. So I'm being able to cast spells and sacrifice myself at the same time. So it's kind of good.
Good to hear. You mentioned Pain there and the time that you left when they wanted you to play 4 or captain. Was that a difficult thing for you, leaving Pain? Or did you think it was necessary?
The change?
Yeah, were you hurt by them asking you to leave? Or... was it not a big problem for you?
So there were those two options, but I never got to choose, actually.
Okay.
They went with misery. So they gave me the two options, but I never chose one of them. When I got back to Brazil and I was ready to think and choose, they were already decided. They went with misery. And I think it most because he was an experienced captain and they needed one. So I understand the decision, and I'm still friends with them.
But was it personally difficult for you to deal with, or did you kind of roll with the punches and understand that this was just something that happens to players?
At the beginning, it was pretty hard, because it made me understand that as a support five, I need to be a captain as well. Otherwise, I'm easily replaceable. So that was a punch I had to take
yeah.
to become a captain, in-game leader. Otherwise, I'll just be replaceable in any team, so I had to take the punch to learn and be a captain. Otherwise, I probably have to be a four.
Do you think Pain was perhaps too big an opportunity for you at that stage of your career, being a 16-year-old, 17-year-old support player? Was it maybe too big a jump attending the international that quickly, or did you learn more than you would have if you just worked your way up through smaller stacks like most people do?
I think we had a long season of learning, but like I was still young, but at the same time, it worked well. Like I didn't immediately enter Pain. We had a week of tryout. So they try out other people as well. They went with me because, I don't know, they trusted me. And even though I was young, that was fine. I think they had a lot of experience already. They played in old SG team that beat a secret in the major. So they all had a lot of experience. And they all had something to teach me. So they found it easier to mold a player instead of having another one that is old and have strong beliefs.
Did you feel a lot of pressure being put into a team like that, kind of one of the biggest South American teams for your whole of your region at such a young age, or did you feel capable to deal with it?
It was a lot of pressure because I was a big fan of them as well. I followed them pretty much their whole careers, and then I was playing by their side. But that was something I always dreamed of doing, so I didn't really care about the pressure, but she was there, obviously.
Yeah. Was the international amazing to attend? Was that a really big moment for you, or did it feel just like another tournament?
It felt like another tournament, mostly because of our performance. We never got to this stage. We played the whole tournament on the hotel. So the pressure was so much that we couldn't handle. And when we lost, it just felt like another tournament. If we took in as just another tournament, we'd do a lot better, I think. But we all had in mind that it was CI and was our biggest chance and etc. And we were doing pretty well. We went there with a third place at the major, so we were very confident and stuff. But as our first TI, I think everyone just crumbled. Felt like a not just another tournament, pretty much playing at the hotel. That was a bit disappointing.
Do you think that's a problem that South America's had quite a lot, in that you're quite a new region and there's a lot of inexperience there and you've often struggled at bigger events? Or do you think that's just that team?
So we struggled big events because most of them play for the first time. But there are exceptions. For example, Biscos, they went to the first TI and they got top 8. The old SG team, they went to the first major and they beat a secret. There is the exceptions, but I think we as a region need more time, for sure. And we need more stability, because people going for the first time, they get replaced and they lost all the experience. So we just need more time, I think.
Are you pleased to see Beast Coast doing so well? Because they are quite a strong team. They've done quite well at the most recent major. Or do you feel a touch of competitiveness with them?
They're an exciting team to watch. I play with them for a couple of months as well, mm-hmm. in an older mix. So I feel excited to see them do it well. It's good for the region, and I hope they get to GI through points. So makes the qualifier easier for us.
Yes, that would be nice, wouldn't it?
It would be nice. Two SA teams at the TI, that would be great. So I'm glad they're doing well.
How's SA to play in at the moment? Is it still quite a tough region to find good quality scrims, or is it improving?
It's slowly improving, but it's still pretty hard. There are good teams here to scrim, I would say, but the issue is they're not very disciplined, so it's hard to play on. Like, most teams don't show up in time and they cancel scrims in the last hour. So there are good things, but it's hard to maintain a good schedule because there's no discipline here. Everyone can do whatever they want. So even though they don't show up to the scrim, you can't really say anything because there are a few things and you don't want to burn yourself. You don't want to get flame in the region. So you just see it happen. But in the end, we play most NA scrims and NA pubs, USCs. It's harder, but it's something we have to do. And I hope with Beast Coast coming back, we have better scrims also. So.
Do you have to play on ping against North America? Do you have quite high pings, or is it doable?
Yeah, we get high pings. 150, I think.
Oh, God.
Peruvians in Peru, they get a lower ping, I think. They get like 100 at max. So that's why you see a lot of Peruvians playing NA servers. Their ping is like playable, I would say. It's super good. And we get the rest of South America gets a bad, worse treatment. We get a high ping.
Would you be tempted to go and boot camp in a different region before qualifiers just to get those better scrims? Or is it you're always going to want to boot camp in South America?
We were thinking about that. And Furia has an offseason in the United States because the CSGO team lives there. So maybe before one qualifier or maybe for a TI qualifier, for example, we can boot camp there for some time just to play easier scrims. And then we come back. Yeah, it's something we have planned, but it will take some time to do.
But is the region getting better? And those problems you mentioned about people turning up late or there not being good enough scrim partners, is it better than it was 2 years ago? Or is there not a level of improvement happening?
It's getting better because we are having more teams now. We have Pain, we have us, Beast Coast, you have Infamous, that they have a lot of experience, they have Timato. So we have a lot more teams now and a lot more options to scrim. So it got better because of that. A year ago when I was playing in Pain Gaming, there was only us and I think SG. SG won a lot of qualifiers as well. So there was only two teams just dominating the region and nobody wanted to scrim because there's no point in screaming. Pain and SG was just going to win everything. And now with three slots, everyone is more competitive and everyone's trying to win. So you have a lot more teams. We're just slowly improving.
Okay. You were quite, at the time, especially last year, you were quite outspoken about the difficulty of foreign talent entering the region, like that Infamous team and Pain Gaming to a degree. Do you think still that that damaged the region, or do you have a different opinion about it now?
So my issue with the Infamous team getting Europeans was that they were quite disrespectful to the region. Like Weha, for example, when he came here, he embraced the region. He embraced our memes and he liked the region. He liked to play here. He played SA pubs without a problem. And what I don't like is when people come to a region for this lot and they are disrespectful. They flame everyone in pubs. They treated us bad in screens. They think they are superior just because they came from another region. I think that's bad. If you come to another region, you should respect the region.
But you're not against, in theory, someone respectful coming and playing in South America or even an all-foreign team who were to fully embrace and live in South America. Would you be up for that?
I think it's great. Having more screen partners is great and better players to learn. It's always great to have people come to our region. That's why we got Weha as well. He teaches so much and I think he improved our region so much. Most of our placements is because of Weha and how well the region is doing now with Beast Coast, I think it's mostly because of Weha. He did a great job here bringing some, not only the European Dota style, but the discipline. He brought a lot of discipline that we needed. So I think it's great to get better players from other regions.
Did you feel, because you were one of the people that was known as being outspoken on that, and I understand your reasons for that, but do you feel you were a bit misunderstood by the community about it, or did you not really pay attention to what the community was saying?
I was not falling, actually, but I think they misunderstood me, because I'm not against it. I'm against some people that come and disrespect the region. Just don't like you disrespecting the region and the pro players that are living here, because we have a very hard time here, so... Don't make it harder. Just come here to make it our life easier, pretty much.
That makes sense. But it feels this year that you have no foreign talent and it's the strongest it's been. Is that a nice place for it to be, that it can be a fully South American region that is growing on its own merits, not necessarily because there are other teams that are coming out of the region? Is that a nice place to be, or would you like to see more people come in so the team can get more, the region can get more experience and grow even further?
I think people are afraid of Beast Coast, maybe? I don't know.
Okay.
But I would like to see some more players and teams from other regions. That would be better to... Even though we lose qualifiers and lose our spots, that would be better to have more screen partners.
Yeah.
But I don't know what is happening or what is coming. I think it's just a hard region to... People realize it's a hard region to leave and play. So
yeah.
I think they gave up.
Are you always going to be wanting to qualify for a DPC event every round? Or do you think you have the leniency with your organization to not qualify for some things and just kind of grow for the next three or so years? Or is there still a pressure in your current organization to succeed? Or do you think that you can fail quite a lot and that'd be fine as a learning experience?
Nah, there's no pressure from FURIA. We spent, I think, 4 or 5 months together before qualifying to the minor. So we lost a lot already. And the goal this year, this season, was getting to a major. So we got to the minor already. We're doing quite well. So the goal pretty much is the major. If we get to the major, great. We have a great season. If we don't, we're going to come back stronger. But I believe we can get even to TI this year. There's no really pressure. We're just having different goals and going step by step, pretty much.
Mm. But if you say get to the major and you get last place, is that, not that I think that would necessarily happen, but it's something that could happen. Is that going to dispirit you? Or do you have this mentality of just I have to learn now? There's no need necessarily for me to get big results. It's all about development.
As long as we give her 100% and we're doing our best every tournament, it's fine. Doesn't matter the placement, as long as we give our best. And FURIA is helping us to get better placements in every tournament. We do long boot camps, and they're investing a lot in us. But there's not really a pressure, because the CSGO team, which we are inspired by, they took a lot of time as well. They lost a lot, and they went through hard times a lot. And FURIA never gave up on them, so it's the same for us. They're giving us a lot of time to just adapt and to do well. When we get to the major, we can get last place. If you give our 100%, it's fine. Next time, we're going to give our 100% again and hope for better results and just come back stronger every time.
It's good to hear. Do you think there are particular areas where the team will improve mostly? You don't have to go into too much specifics so people know how to beat you, but do you think there are things that are particularly weak about FURIA at the moment that will become stronger over the next couple of months?
I think we lack consistency now.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why we just we lack consistency pretty much. And when we replace players, it gets worse. Like, when in a good day we can beat anyone, and in a bad day we can lose to anyone. That was something we learned in playing the boot camp in Kiev. We had great screens there. We were winning against tough opponents, but in a bad day we can lose to anyone pretty much. So we lack the consistency. And we should stop doing holster changes to make it better. So yeah, or this season we will focus on being more consistency, and maybe we can improve that. We can win every qualifier pretty much.
Okay. Do you see Pain Gaming as the main rival apart from Beast Coast in the region, or are there other teams like Infamous that you think are stronger or as strong as you?
I think Pain is just our biggest opponent now. It's outside of Peace Coast, obviously. But there's one team that is coming up, a Peruvian team called Thunder Predator. They are very good also. So we're going to keep an eye on them. But it's mostly Pain Gaming. And they are Brazilian as well, so there's some rivalry already. It's an emotional game.
Is it easier to play with an all-Brazilian team? Or do you think there can be more? Because quite a lot of what's weird about South America compared to other regions is the teams tend to be quite single nationality, whereas Europe is very cross-regional. Is it much easier language-wise just to play with only Brazilians, or are you up for playing with people from across the region?
Yeah, language-wise, it's much better to have a full Brazilian team.
Mm-hmm.
People tried before mixing Peruvians and Brazilians, but it doesn't work because both of them doesn't know English, and one knows Spanish, the other Portuguese. So there's no common ground, there's no middle term. So it's way better to have full Brazilian or full Peruvian. You can add some people from outside if your team have a good English. For example, last year in Pain, we had an okay English, so that was fine to have with her. But we had many issues.
Mm-hmm.
Still. Like, it's easy to talk in English playing Dota, but in your routine, in day, day by day, it's pretty hard. Like, you're used to just saying everything in Portuguese. So the day can be harder. Living together can be harder. But playing Dota is the easiest part.
Because your English is relatively strong, I think. Would you ever want to move out of South America into a different region like Europe or North America?
I thought about it before, but I didn't have the opportunity. So that's why I didn't do the move. Mm-hmm. If I got one opportunity, sure, I would. Before, I would do it. Now, I won't. I prefer staying here with Furia. And one of our goals in Furia is to live in North America as well, with the CSGO team. So when we get to be the best in South America, we're going to go in there and live in North America. So in the end, it's the same. We're going to swap the regions anyway. So for now, I don't look to it. But before, if I had the opportunity, I would go for sure.
Okay, I think that's closest to all I've got for you. What's coming up next for the team? Is it just more qualifiers, or are you doing any online tournaments or anything?
I think we're going to boot camp. I think we're going to the boot camp in 4 days.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just the next qualifiers. But you should definitely follow Furia and the players on Instagram, because something we do different here in Brazil, we do a lot of content. We create a lot of content with the organization.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something different. You don't see a lot of content from Beast Coast and Pain, for example. But here in Furia, we're doing something different. We pretty much post every day about the bootcamp and how it's going, like backstage stuff. So yeah.
Do you enjoy doing it?
Yeah, it's pretty fun to be in touch with your fans, because they're the reason we get to play. They're the reason we live our dreams. So it's always nice to be in touch with them, and they get less toxic when you put yourself out and just show yourself. They understand you more when you talk about backstage stuff, when you show the team practicing and stuff, or day by day. When you show that, people get more excited about the team, so it's easier to deal with them later when bad stuff happens. Yeah.
That's nice. That's good to hear. Okay, just before we close up, is there anything you'd like to bring up or plug yourself?
Just make sure you follow everyone on Instagram, especially Furia. And we're gonna boot camp in 4 days. And yeah, we're gonna play the next qualifier. We're aiming for the major. I hope it's our first major. And
it'd be nice.
Thanks for everyone listening.
Thank you for listening to Position 6, and a huge thanks to Duster for coming on. I really enjoyed talking to him, and I'm looking forward to seeing what he does over the next couple of years with this team. Thank you once again for all of your support so far. Again, if you want to follow me on Twitter, I can be found at Daniel Offen, and that's spelled Daniel and then O-F-F-E-N. If you've tuned into this live broadcast late, then you'll be able to find a link to the full episode there. If you'd like to financially support the show because you think it's an enterprise it's worth paying for, you can follow me on Patreon, which should be listed in the episode description, and I do massively appreciate whatever support I get there. As a part of this, I'd like to thank several of my most favourite supporters. Firstly, Christopher Strong, then Mark Wernall, and then Paradox State and the wonderful laser light displays, and then finally Teddy Snow. So thanks guys for all of your support, I do massively appreciate it. Next week, I'm not 100% sure who it's going to be. It's quite difficult with all the roster shipping and changing at the moment to work out exactly who's able to come on and who's able to talk about what. But when that's all finished, I should be able to get a good guest. If not, I'll invite an old favourite back on. Either way, there's going to be a good episode, so head to my Twitter for updates on that. But until then, though, thanks again for listening, and I'll see you next week. Go!